fine, it got published in the Lancet, it got acknowledgement in research field. But if you want to scale it up nationally, every year 27 million newborn babies are born in India. And nearly 1 million of them die every year. So, through advocacy based on the evidence generated in Gadchiroli and through repeated trials that were done in India, in Maharashtra, evidence was powerful enough that the Planning Commission was convinced, Health Ministry was convinced, and this became part of the NRHM. And nationally, home-based newborn care was launched. Ashas were trained. So we developed a training methodology in which we trained national trainers and district trainers in search using a specific training materials and modules. And they in turn trained 8 lakh Asha in almost who provide home-based newborn care in almost every village in India today. So nearly 20 million neonates are receiving home-based newborn care in 800,000 villages and hamlets in India. Except for Tamil Nadu and Kerala, where anyway IMR is very low, so they did not need home-based newborn care. Every other state has adopted this. So the challenge of child deaths in India, 16 lakh totally, and half of these neonates could be saved. The last question, and I'll stop at that. What could I do, and by that I mean really, what could I do for you, or what could you do with this innovation? Last my name. One, introduce home-based newborn care in your working area. If you have community health workers, if not, adopt. There are several trials have been done. One Ankur trial in which 7 NGOs in Maharashtra introduced home-based newborn care. Recently, Tata Steel in Jharkhand and America India Foundation with the help of search replicated this through CSR model, and it there also enormously was effective. So it could be introduced in other areas, whether by NGOs or whether by corporate sector. Facilitated NGOs and state governments to use various training aids, skills, DVD set, for example, here you can see. These are the training materials, training manual using which community health workers can be trained, flip chart using which mother can be given health education, a CD using which skills can be imparted to community health worker, and a story book, stories of how community health workers in villages after villages saved mothers and babies. So these can be used in any program to introduce home-based newborn care. So essence of the approach is innovate locally and then execute globally. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Abhay. I think our speaker is Dr. Pooja. Dr. Pooja is Jaipur Foot. So while the presentation is started, let me give a brief overview. Dr. Pooja is the director of Jaipur Food and Rehab Center. Since 1985, they've done the touched the lives of more than 1.3 million people. And you know, one of the significant work is in collaborative research with Stanford University, they created this prosthetic Jaipur knee, which was considered as one of the 50 best innovations by the Time magazine. A big welcome to you, Dr. Pooja.
The subject concerning the marginalized has been brought to the forefront of public dialogue. I thank the Deshpande Foundation for giving me this opportunity. The Jaipur Foot organization works with amputees, that is people who've lost their limbs, in India and around the world. We help them be restored to a mobile and dignified form. I wonder how many of you have actually seen an amputee? Because if you haven't, I have my patient here. You can take a look at him. Santosh. The amputee population globally is rising at an alarming rate. With ever-increasing wars, the continuing legacy of landmines, accidents, and diabetes. 80% of this population lives in the low and middle income countries. But ironically, most of the research is directed towards the 20% living in the developed world. The available devices are prohibitively priced and beyond the reach of end users in India and the developing world. However, they are so strikingly different in the two parts of the world. Amputees in the developed world would be mostly seniors, 60 to 65 years of age, who would have lost the limb through a vascular insufficiency with or without diabetes. They would have a short lifespan and restricted mobility. In fact, 50% of amputees in America have only a 5-year survival, which is worse than cancer of the breast, prostate, or colon. On the other hand, amputees in India and also rest of the world, the rest of the developing world, are young, healthy men who are mostly 30 years or under, who unfortunately met with an accident and lost their limb. They have the most productive years of their lives ahead of them. Also, in terms of lifestyle, there are striking differences. Amputees in the West are required to walk on level floors, level surfaces. They sit on chairs. They live in a cold climate and always wear shoes. Amputees in India are mostly from the rural areas, so they are required to negotiate terrain that is very challenging, rugged. They mostly use the floor as a work surface, and even cultural norms demand that they sit on the floor. Living in a hot climate, many of them prefer to not use shoes. So clearly, the same solutions cannot work for two such strikingly contrasted groups. So the Jaipur Foot organization, it wasn't an organization then, it was just a center. A team of local craftsmen with very primitive rustic tools, supervised and guided by orthopedic surgeons who had no formal training in prosthetics, set out to indigenously design their own prosthesis for their own people, largely the Indian amputees, that would meet the social, cultural, occupational, environmental, and religious needs of the population that they were serving. They designed a beautiful, versatile foot, which is now popularly known around the world as the Jaipur foot. Incidentally, it is a design that's most widely used around the world. So the Jaipur foot permits amputees to squat, sit cross-legged, climb trees, even jump off trees. Since it's made of microcellular rubber, it provides very good ground reaction absorption of ground reaction forces. In fact, and this is what I meant when I said religious considerations, because that could be a sensitive issue. By religious, I mean that people could take off shoes and use the limb without a shoe. So people could enter temples, go to mosques, and even adopt challenging postures like you see here. Basically, depending on what an amputee set out to do, the Jaipur foot permits that person to achieve that. You know, climb trees, run, ride a bike, anything. Children can indulge in sports. If you're a dancer, you can even dance like our brand ambassador Sudha Chandran did. So we started out with local craftsmen, but we've come a long way. And now we work some of the brightest mechanical engineers from MIT and Stanford. In collaboration with Stanford University, we developed a very high-performance, affordable knee joint for people who lost the limb above the knee, like Santesh here. And this knee is now ISO 10328 certified and was launched globally. It was launched in the US on December 8, 2015. So we are actually innovating locally and globally now, and executing globally too. This is Sanjay, and as you can see, for him, riding a bike is as important as walking. In fact, bike accidents are the single largest cause of amputations in India. And most of our patients come back to us asking, fine, we'll be able to walk with the Jaipur limb, but will we be able to go back to riding a bike? And so we have to, ultimately you have to serve the user in what he needs. This is Pankaj, who also passionate about his bike. This is Saddam Hussein, a scary name, but before and after his Jaipur limb. This is again Pankaj, who's gone back to being a mechanic with the Jaipur limb. This is Dodaram. Dodaram was born a farmer, and with a Jaipur limb, he can continue to be one for the rest of his life. This is Ram Nivas taking a break, but you must notice that he's taking a break in a posture that's a norm in the rural areas. Here, again, Ram Nivas and Dodaram are exchanging some notes. So although the Jaipur Fort and the Jaipur Limb was designed to meet the social, cultural, occupational, environmental needs of the Indian amputee, the design that evolved has features that make it appropriate for global use. So Jaipur Limb is currently being used in over 35 countries across the developing world. So this is Zambia, Iraq, Lebanon, Senegal, Fiji, Sri Lanka, Pakistan. And as Shiva already mentioned, the knee joint that we designed in partnership with Stanford University featured as one of the 50 best inventions of the year 2009. The Jaipur Foot organization has since inception provided assistive aids to over 1.5 million people, all at no cost to the patient. When we provide an artificial limb, from a medical perspective, it is trying to restore a lost body part. In the social context, we are providing an enabler in an inaccessible environment. And from an economic standpoint, we are trying to provide access to patients for education, employment, and thereby acting as a poverty elevator. Having worked with amputees for 27 years now, I still continue to be deeply impressed by the indomitability of the human spirit in the face of overwhelming odds. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Dr. Shiban, and welcome to the stage, Dr. Shiban. So, he's a founder and chief volunteer. I really love the title, chief volunteer, for Save a Mother. A physician in one of my favorite parts of the world, the Chicago area, is also the founder of the Indian American Medical Association, executive director of the American Indian Foundation, and a very interesting role he has also done as being a major in the Indian Army in the past. So he's got a lot of values, and one very interesting quote I saw from him is, stay inside the box. So welcome to the panel, doctor, and we have time to yours.
Truly, Abhay Bang has been an inspiration, and I've taken off from his work and see what else can we do to replicate or supplement his work. If you see, healthcare delivery model has been supply side. Then we supply doctors, we supply drugs, devices, nurses. It's all been supply side the world over. But very little work has been done on the demand side of healthcare. Can we improve demand somehow to access healthcare more intelligently? For the demand to be effective, the consumer has to have two things: A, knowledge; B, money. We as an organization so far have been providing knowledge, and I'll define the word knowledge in a minute, to access care given by Dr. Ramani, care given by Dr. Abhay Bang, and many brilliant doctors, and the government, and the NRHM, in a little more intelligent way. Knowledge to me is one that modifies your behavior. I take it from information is what's available and data within a context. But for information to become knowledge, which is usable knowledge for you, your family, and community, there's a shift, there's a change. And that is the change that we're trying to discover. And we have stumbled upon it. I don't know whether it's really successful or not in the long term, but we stumbled upon it. At least we know how to change information to knowledge. The people are on autopilot to modify their behavior forever. Now, the social behavior modification in a scientific way is a new field, just 4 or 5 years old. A lot of work is going on. We call our models effective social persuasion model. What we do is a responsibility-based approach. As you see the paradigm at the moment, the world over, health is a human right, and I contribute to it. Health should be a human right, but we twist it a little bit that unless you're responsible, you don't even understand your rights. So it has to be a responsibility-based approach at the consumer level, that you're responsible for your health, health of your street, health of your village, health of your community. Number two, we encourage voluntary health activism. If you remember, before 1950, all healthcare was a non-for-profit. Very strange behavior, but the behavior has been modified. Religious organization, when you're born, you're allotted a religion, and then you live with it for the rest of your life and do strange things with that religion. Now what do they do? There are four things common in all religions. Number one,
so last speaker is Rajabali, and Rajabali is a program manager with Deshpande Foundation. So he currently works on the Darwad Chronic Malnutrition Free Project and Deshpande Shushudhi Electrical Program. He has been 5 years in the development sector. Next few minutes.
We have given the 1,800 children data. So we started with nothing knowing because we went with a solution without knowing the problem. That what we gave, all the 3,018 children, we taught micronutrients and we suggested all the governance system to distribute it. We have given it. Later, after just 15 days, we went to the field. But wherever we go, all around the 180 villages we surrounded, there is no single micronutrient went to the children. So that is the second. After that, like when government says in the Dharwad district, there are only 318 children. So when we started again, because we are new into the program, we are not an expert in this specific area. When we started again learning, like we have Anand sir from WHO and like Hiremat sir we have, and we have that after that we just go through the training and everything, what WHO says, what is it, what exactly is that, this whole thing. After that we thought like first focus on that, the delivery part, the process, what we have to have, that we have to respond, and the data that we focus with. So that like just brief about the fact, that doesn't take more time. So it's the main, like if you look at the data, the mother, what we are working, and all the doctors, sir, I'm not a doctor professionally, and he can help me to again explain it properly. So that like it is just like a global nutrition report, which is introduced and brought 2015 recently. The data, what you see, almost many of the percentages or the data are towards increasing to be more malnourished children in India. Specifically, right, like if you look at the women, if you look at like all the children, that you, the rate you see, the 13.8.7 children are stunted in India. So that was like more thinking that, and again we have 15.1% are wasted, and after that like again low birth rate is a major part. When we started doing survey, all the 3018 children, so almost the 50% of children are who are in malnourished, they are all underweight children, specifically born with a low birth rate. So that our intervention are completely, first we focused more on like connecting and tracking mothers and the children. There we focused more. It's more like with the having and believing the objective of the improving SAM children in the Dharwad district, identified by WCD department, Karnataka government. So that after that, like to design nutritional intervention, even I think we have Anand here who helped us again designing all the intervention that all thing. And after that, like so slowly we started how we work specifically in complete district. So we start with the data collection. We collect all the data. We go door by door. And if you look at the government data, so when they have given 3,018 children, when we started door by door data collection, we got 3 times more data in the ground. So that was the reality. So that is what even when we went to government to show up that government is not at all ready to accept it. So then again, they said like they not at all given a permission, that even Deshpande Foundation has a good support and the good like rapport in the district. That's what they allowed afterwards. We grew on and we made a strong process. And then later, like we started the medical intervention with the help of SDM and with the help of some consultant, we distribute all the micronutrient and like macronutrient. After that, like we start like nutritional intervention. The nutritional intervention, what we do specifically, first we focus more on home-based food. There we more sensitized, because many of like I have many examples in old Hubballi. So they say whenever I go home, sir, sleep chahi bache sir, they say. Like if you ask, like, because this is a more population issue. So that like the ratio of in that again the 2018 children, the more than 65 female children are malnourished children. So that like we started nutritional intervention, completely sensitizing the community, where we focus on counseling them and focusing on balancing food, focusing on completely like food practices. Because if child likes only rice, the mother gives only rice for 1 year, 2 year, 3 year, the child may not be like get at all the nutrition. After that, like in that, there are like after the screening with medical intervention and without medical intervention. With medical intervention, we refer them for hospitals. Without medical interventions, where we believe all the malnourished children, 80 to 90% of the children we can prevent you in health, in the community itself. So then, like we also like started with a very pairing system. We one of the agriculture introduced a laddu which includes like 7 like seeds. So that they have given, but like unfortunately, some of the seeds in that got failed and given allergic to the children. Again, we got failed in that and we get scolded by community. Again, we did not give up that. So later, like again, we studied more and with the help of like some other thing, we introduced RMTF. That we started later, like a package of that 3 months. That after that, later spirulina we have introduced. After that, locally made dry banana we have started to giving it, and then we covered in the nutritional intervention. The sanitation intervention is more on hygiene. So nail cutting activity and hand washing activity, that we will focus more. and trainings. In that training, specifically the group of 20, 30 and 25 group volunteer we create in that, and we train all the other teachers and mothers and to do more, because everybody only focus and blame only the rural people. Because see, the Anganwadi teacher supposed to maintain 31 files within a month. She is supposed to report. Do you think like reporting that all the things? Because she become a now government clerk. She cannot like give education, cannot give proper consideration that all the things. So that we as a like specifically going on under nutrition, so that we started sensitizing that all the things. The follow-up, for follow-upping, so we have introduced a few of apps, mobile apps, where we can like collect the data, where we can screen the children in the field itself, because that was the biggest part in the ground. So that later we SAM check app, it is available for screening, weight for age, we have introduced. Then ODK for data collection is a one-time effort, collect all the 270 columns data, including socioeconomy, health, parametric, basic data and everything. So that we have only a KPI, it is just like, it doesn't take much time, whatever data you have, just if you push it to the internet, that server, you get the, all the analysis data. Then we have Joho creator, which is like live data verification, we can do it. So that like sitting that through your program manager and the CEO of the program, that he can look at completely that where the fields are and where they are working, whether they have given food or not, that we have introduced. So that like recently we have like celebrated out of in a pilot study, we have taken around 3,500 children we have taken, and in the 500 within a like 1 year, so almost 361 children got over the SAM. They graduated from SAM to normal. With that like method, so now we are working with 3,000 children. So this is all about that, like specifically we started more like pushing in the executing locally. So that now we started again innovating globally. Thank you. Thank you.
Social enterprise. And the beauty of a leveraged social enterprise is that it does what the government is supposed to do much, much better than the government could ever do it. But in India, it's not just one government. It's 27 governments, and then the big government, and then all the governments. So the problem with a leveraged social enterprise in India is it still doesn't scale very well, because it has to deal with all those governments. So if you look at the way all of you are developing your innovations, the big win is to get into a big state or your state or the state where you want to work, and then to expand from there slowly, progressively, and so on. What that means is that a lot of the innovations that you need to scale, you're not able to scale because they don't ever hit critical mass. So if somebody brings a protein product to the market that starts out being 60, 40% less, but could be 70% less if it were at scale, it'll take decades for that product to get to the scale necessary to get it down to 70% savings, and therefore decades to get it to all of the people that can have it between 40 and 70 off. So I guess the thing I'm trying to understand as an outsider is, do we just have to live with that? Or is there some way you guys and some of us who care about doing this globally, not just within India, could work together to create a forcing function or a group of forcing functions that would enable governments to see that they have to de-risk this stuff? If they want it to go to scale, the governments have to get together with you and de-risk it, so that you're not working one state at a time. And I love the way, Abhishek, your program is scaling to multiple states, but how long did it take you to get there?
As you rightly said, as far as blindness prevention is concerned, we have formed a national body called Vision 2020 Right to Sight. So that's a national organization of which all of us are members, the major players are members, and that represents the government constantly. And again, you rightly said, every state has got its own policies. We need to really see that they see the good in what we are trying to do. It takes a lot of time, a lot of effort. Sometimes it even becomes a stumbling block. Just to tell you, there is a program called National Program for Control of Blindness, under which the government of India is supposed to give 1,000 rupees for every free surgery. That's the support. While the actual expenditure is 4,000. Still, 25% is 25%. But it takes years and years, sometimes it never comes. So, a lot of liaisoning has to be done. And the reality is, it takes time. As he said, 8 years. Now, for us, 12 hospitals, it has again taken close to around 8 to 10 years.
Look, it's always unequal partnership. And though NGOs have come together, for example, for home-based newborn care, we have formed national fronts, an international organization like Save Children US, they have supported this. Still, the partnership with the government is always unequal. And the real challenge is when it comes to execution, how to maintain the processes and quality parameters. So it's a sort of trade-off. In my experience, it's a sort of trade-off. You go for a big size by getting your innovation into the government program, but it also means there is a risk of some dilution of the quality. Because as you very rightly said, even one state government has got 30-40 districts and there may be 500 PSCs. What happens at those 500 PSCs, even that state director doesn't know. When it comes to the national level, what is happening in 500,000 villages, hardly anybody knows. So there are process and quality considerations which are at the risk of getting compromised. The practical solution, not 100% successful, but practical solution I found was create policy framework, training methodology which is very rigorous and standardized, and then monitoring and evaluation system. But in spite of all these, a lot of loopholes are left
out. Because there are major access issues with people who are disabled, and it is very important to take your services as close to them as possible, because it may take them years or even a lifetime for them to reach you. So as soon as we set up our center in Jaipur, we started branching out and we have centers in 25 states in the country. And incidentally, in India, we have a very progressive Disabilities Act, where on paper, the government is supposed to be pro people with disability. But it's unable to implement that act, and if there are players in the field who are willing to take on that responsibility and the government is not acting like a roadblock for us, I think it's fine. And I feel personally I would not want to depend on the government entirely. I think it's time we took responsibility, and most of the time, or the time that we spend complaining about the government not doing anything, if we would spend it proactively trying to make things change, I think we would be better off. So I think just take responsibility.
Government is supposed to provide children in a meal, 3 days meal, 3 days end, ration, and mother also get a ration, and if it is a severely acute malnutrition, it get double ration. But like when you look at and go to the ground, if we ask them, do you get this other thing? Sir, we get this other thing. Because our awareness, what we talk, that is less. And there are few teachers, they also are very good in distributing this other thing. So one teacher, what she has done is, so she is supposed to get 2.5 rupees for each child. Even you never get for 3 rupees also again the ground. So what she has done, 18 eggs she brought at a time and given to the house. When I went to the next day, they all prepared one day itself. It is kind of like festival for them in that. So that everything is gone. That is more like people participation is more like I believe.
Sure. Comes to execution, that is the precious 4 to 6 hours which occurs after death. There is a relative, lot of gap between the demand and supply with related to adoration. Now, Dr. Ramani, tell the causes for this, what is the reason for that, and what are the remedies for this? 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Yes, thank you.
Yeah, my name is George Abraham, and I am visually impaired since birth, and I had visited a doctor, a examined me and he said that there's nothing that I can do for you. This is the case with millions of visually impaired people in this country. We go to doctors with a lot of hope, with a lot of belief. I'm not saying that the doctor should heal, but what I'm trying to say is most doctors, and I've worked with about 3,000 doctors in the last 5 years as part of my work, the majority of them do not know what can be done if treatment is not possible. Life can go on, life does go on, and life goes on splendidly well if advised correctly. And I believe that doctors have a tremendous opportunity to trigger a good life in a blind person whose eyesight cannot be treated, a person with disability. So what I'd like to ask Dr. Ramani is, how can we actually mobilize doctors to use their station in life as next to God when it comes to a visually impaired person, to actually mobilize doctors of our country to actually use that opportunity and their station to actually help blind people start thinking about life rather than cure?
Thank you. Both questions to Dr. Ramani.
I'll quickly answer. To be registered with the Eye Bank Association of India. And it was a very tough time. We started motivating the community. And today, we receive a pair of eyes every day. Not a day passes without getting a pair of eyes. The community has been motivated to such an extent, when that inevitable calamity takes place in a household, even before asking, have you informed your relatives, they have started asking, have you informed Shankar either? This is the way we have motivated the people, okay? Still, I agree with you, the demand is huge. This has to, it's only a few places where we are having our eye back. The solution is creating awareness in the minds of the public in general as an ongoing phenomenon. We used to have huge hoardings to say, do not bury, do not burn, donate eyes, it is divine. These are all things which have to be taken up in a very big way to mobilize the people. So that is, so awareness is the key, number one. We have the technology, awareness is the key. Once you create awareness, people are willing to come forward. No one says no. You need to create enough. There are myths and misconceptions. You need to clear that. Second thing, the doctor you mentioned about the, we have an unwritten dictum in Shankara. None of our doctors could tell anybody that nothing can be done. That is the worst thing a doctor can tell to anybody. We have preventive, curative, but there is a rehabilitative eye care. Anybody, being blind is not the end of the day. There are great people who have been blind, but they learned so much in their life. God has been compassionate. He takes away vision, but he has given something else. Much more, 10 times, 100 times. So we have, if you happen to come to Bangalore, come to our hospital in Martahalli, we have a huge rehabilitation center. And now we are coming out next month with a mobile rehabilitation unit which goes from place to place. Of course, doctors have to be brought into this picture. They have to be created. I mean, there is awareness even among the medical fraternity that people could be referred. One case is the retinoblastoma. Some of you might know cancer affecting the eye. We are one of the two institutions having facility to treat, save the eye, save the vision, save the life. But a lot of children go undetected unless you see them early enough. And it is done totally free if the child is poor at our Bangalore hospital. Now two things, I just took it up from doctor when he mentioned in his speech, two offerings. There are a lot of people who are in the social sector here. In your area, if you are willing to set up vision centers, we are willing to support in whatever way we can, number one. Number two, if you want to give a job-oriented and job-guaranteed vocational training, for girls from your villages or neighboring villages, again, please get in touch with us. The second thing. And of all the various activities what we do, my wife, Dr. Radha, who is the co-founder, she has taken up a rural development program for the past 15 years. It's a comprehensive rural development program. It is not just lopsided. She took health as an entry point, 80,000 rural population totally in 14 villages, very devoid villages, health as an entry point, get the confidence of those people. Then she brought in water supply, involve the government. It's easy in your own area, you can convince the district magistrate. Water supply to all of them. And the third one is sanitation. Now every house has got a toilet in those villages now. Fourth one is preschool education. Someone mentioned in the morning session about preschool education before 5 years.
We listen to the people and you'll be surprised. Sometimes when necessary, we do voting. In the tribal health assembly, all the representatives vote. If there are 10 priorities emerged in the discussion, we conduct voting. For example, in our first tribal health assembly, malaria was voted as the highest priority. We went for that. So that's one way of distinguishing and giving priority. Second way is that we measure morbidity and mortality burden through a meticulous surveys and epidemiologic studies. So we know which is, third is of course feasibility. Yes, there could be a big problem, but if there is no technological or feasible solution available, what can I do? I have to postpone it to sometime later. There is a good matrix for deciding priorities when you have multiple priorities. The severity of the disease, the frequency or the magnitude of the problem, consequences, feasibility of solution, and the cost effectiveness. Based on that, out of the various possibilities, you select one. For example, there could be a rare disease. So though it's a fancy disease, but if it is a rare disease and it is affecting, let's say, 1% in 10 villages, will I make that as my priority? So the magnitude, severity, feasibility, and the cost. And I would like to add fifth one, acceptance by the community. So if you use those five criteria, it's possible to come out very objectively measured priorities for public health action.
I think the government intervention for scaling up, Dr. Abhay has worked a lot with the government, and he knows the main roads. From my point of view, to quote the Reserve Bank Governor, we're suffering from current action deficit. And from my point of view, the government needs behavior modification. They're willing to listen. They're willing to listen. I haven't found a bureaucrat who's not willing to listen. But what happens between information and the knowledge that is acting on the information that it receives is an enigma I really don't know. But I also know if you create a file, a folder in the government and give it to a joint secretary, in 6 years or 8 years, it gets acted upon, becomes a law. I have no idea how it happens. But you can change the policy at a very slow pace. I'm sure Dr. Abhay Bang worked on NRHM for minimum 20 years before it became the government policy. So I don't really understand that. From my point of view, we are willing to work for multiple diseases. Our cost of operations is very low. We spend 10 to 15,000 rupees per village per year. And we have four running programs at the moment in four districts: tuberculosis control, population stabilization, maternal mortality reduction, and of course with that goes with infant mortality reduction. And we seem to be succeeding to the same extent by not going to the clinical care that the others are doing, but just creating demand awareness and modification of their behavior. Even at the local level, the CMOs are not willing to listen. They give you a hearing, but then body language tells you they're not interested.
Thank you.
Initiatives like if you, even you cannot believe those are opportunities that we have for children, men, women, and that. As being in social development sector, as an organization, what we're supposed to do is like specifically making more sensitization the ground so that like community should know what all the facilities they're supposed to get. Thank you.
Not do any government bashing. I just say be the change that you want to see. And don't fall on this, you know, just blaming the government for everything. Because what percentage of us forms the government? The government is this and we are this. So, I mean, if each of us decide to change things, the government can't stop us. But it's just that we're just waiting for somebody else to do the work for us. And for people with disabilities, you know, like Dr. Abraham said, how doctors can say that nothing can be done. I think that's that should be qualified as criminal, you know, for doctors to be doing that. And for most of my patients, I generally tell them to not let what they can't do interfere with what they can. Because there's very little that they can't do. Everything else, I mean, they're just normal. It's just that they can't see. It's such a small thing. And just that they lost a leg doesn't stop them from, you know, carrying on with life just like any of us, sometimes a little better. Like you can see Santosh now, the transformation. Santosh, can you walk and show?
Yeah.
You saw him on a wheelchair. This boy was born without three limbs. One would imagine that, you know, one would rather not be alive without three limbs. And you see, I mean, I got him here especially from my center because I wanted people to see that, you know, we are just prejudiced about disability and we just sort of judge people on
what... The theme of this panel is the last mile delivery. So, who resides at the last mile? A person, a family, a community. So, taking preventive health to the last mile delivery, the best approach is empower the person or the community which is living at the last mile. Healthcare, whether government or private or NGOs, will always have limitations of human resource and financial resources. So the best way to reach the last mile is empower the person who lives at the last mile. Taking further the logic of this conference theme, innovate globally, execute locally. I already said I would like to twist it and say innovate locally and then execute globally, because innovations must always emerge in the reality of the local reality. So innovate locally, execute globally. But how do you execute globally? I would add further, execute globally by empowering locally. Thank you.
It's a prejudice, and the last mile delivery itself is a prejudice. To me, it's the first mile delivery. Yeah. The same supply side way of thinking has to go out. It ought to be the mile, in fact, the first water mile or first 10 meters delivery, right in the home that they've done. The last mile is the government.
You know, it's really unbelievable the level of brain power and the level of impact these people have had. They have touched the lives of millions of people. A big, huge round of applause.